Wait a minute. Wait a minute. You ain't heard nothing yet.
Hi, this is Virginia White of Earth, Wind & Fire, and you're listening to The Sweet Spot on WBAI.
Hi, this is Ruth Pointer of the Pointer Sisters, and you're listening to The Sweet Spot on WBAI 99.5 FM.
It's the incredible Mr. Roy Ayers. Woo-hoo!
Hello. Hello, everybody.
Tune in to The Sweet Spot with Baby K and DJ Kyle McNeil. Tell them what we do, Kyle.
Every Thursday at 10 p.m., we will be featuring some of the best in soulful sounds with in-depth interviews with your favorite artists, special theme shows, and, you know, guest hosts.
Yeah, it's a pretty good time, ain't it?
Yep, because we're The Sweet Spot. Thursdays, 10 p.m. only on WBAI 99.5 FM, streaming online at WBAI.org.
Listener-sponsored community radio.
I left Youngstown, Ohio when I was 10 years old.
Wow. My uncle's from Youngstown.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so we have that in common. I actually grew up not far from Cleveland, so I know. It's kind of
so
slow.
You know, east side, south side, west side, north side.
Yeah.
And the bottom.
Yeah. So now you came to New Jersey.
Yes.
And then you became cool. Like, how did the evolution happen?
Well, I mean, coming to Jersey City.
Mm-hmm. What was it like back then?
I was trying to fit in, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, my mother sent me to the store and to get a loaf of bread. This guy walked up and took my money, took my quarter.
Oh.
So I said, Lucy Bell was on the quarter back then. Okay. I said, no, wait a minute, how am I going to deal with this? They're going to be jumping on me and taking my money, or I'm going to have to join them.
Uh-huh.
I decided to join them.
I heard you became the leader, too.
Yes, sure did. We had about 50 strong.
Wow.
But at that time, they called me Tamango.
Uh-huh. Why?
Because that was about the movie, the African Tamango came to America.
That's right.
He was very rebellious and, you know.
Okay.
So, and a group was called the Imperial Lords.
Wow.
Those were
okay.
The guys that I was with, yeah.
Okay.
But, you know, I got out of that.
So you got another gang, basically.
Yeah,
just a musical gang.
Yeah, I became cool. I saw a guy named, called himself Cool, spelled it with a C.
Uh-huh.
I said, I like that name. So I changed it and spelled it with a K.
Mm-hmm.
Not knowing that was the beginning of Kool in the Gang.
Right.
That would be a whole nother story.
Yo, yeah.
It got me off the streets.
Yeah.
Got me into the Boys and Girls Club, and we used to rehearse there, and...
That's beautiful. You know, I work at a girls' club.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. I teach little girls how to DJ and how to do music production and radio.
He's doing
and
something
stuff.
Like that. Well, that's all.
You guys have to visit. We have fun.
Okay. And that's going back to the Cool Kids Foundation, you know, because I was able to get off the streets and go to the Boys and Girls Club and rehearse there. Matter of fact, my wife and I, we had a few meetings with the Boys and Girls Club.
Uh-huh.
And
that's
we were
dope.
Going to do a couple of things with the Boys and Girls Club.
Because you know what a difference it can make. So what was the turning point? Like, what convinced you to actually pick up a bass and, like, form your new musical gang instead of just...
All right. I was... our trumpet player, Spike Mickens, brother played guitar.
Okay.
And I would go to his house. And I learned how to play one song on one string called Coming Home Baby.
Okay.
So we're at the cafe, because I played bongos, the percussion.
Okay.
And my brother said, hey, why don't you borrow that guy's bass, man, and play this song?
Uh-huh.
I said, I don't know how to play no bass, man. He said, you know that song you play on the guitar at Spike's house?
Uh-huh.
So that night I played Coming Home Baby on one string.
Uh-huh. And then you was hooked ever since.
And there
the
was.
Rest is history.
There it was.
Wow. That is so dope. So now you have a longstanding history with the people in the band. So there's those same four have been with you since the beginning. Your brother.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Who did most of the arrangements. George Brown, right? Is
right.
a drummer.
Drummer, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And Dennis Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
And then the three who have passed, which were in the original band.
Yeah, Ricky West, Spike, and Charles.
Mm-hmm. God bless them. I know they're here with us. And it's funny, as I think we spoke with Verdine White of Earth, Wind, and Fire about how you pour so much love and creativity into something that the band become its own force. So
yeah, I just spoke to Verdine yesterday. He called me.
Yeah. Wonderful gentleman.
All about love and music, yeah.
Wow, wonderful gentleman. So it becomes its own kind of force of nature. But you're still dealing with people, right?
Mm-hmm.
How on earth did you manage to have a musical marriage with these people for over 50 years? Like, what is the secret?
It's something you got to work out. I mean, you have your good times and your bad times.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, you want to move forward. Our parents always told us, whatever you do, make sure you stick together.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
And
so every argument is a compliment. Okay, let's keep it moving, keep it grooving.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Do you feel like you were the businessman of the group? Like you were the one who kind of like kept the peace and kept it together in that way?
Well, I would say to some degree. George Brown also very business as well.
Mm-hmm.
My brother Galicia, he was more on the music side. You know,
He did all the arrangements. Wonderful.
And Charles was great in terms of his style of playing, because a lot of guitarists would say, well, how's he playing? Is that two guitar players?
Mm.
Charles came up with them lines, like in Kool the Gang.
Mm-hmm. Those iconic, those riffs that are just
You
know, that lived again and again because people sampled y'all.
Yeah. Even Prince complimented him and said, man, that was the first song I was playing was funky stuff. Can't get enough.
That is dope. That makes sense. Knowing Prince. But I want to talk to you, like, y'all were so young when you started. So I imagine, and it seemed like a lot happened fairly quickly. Like, I know you opened for McCoy Tyner in New Jersey. Like, that must have been something. So who were some of the people that really were iconic to you and inspiration? And at that young age, like you couldn't have imagined all this 50 years later.
Mm-hmm.
Where did you see yourself? Like, what was your goal? Were you just playing because it was fun? Or, like, did you always have a vision?
Well, at that time, we started off at the Jazz Yaks.
Right,
and
that's right.
What you're talking about is mm-hmm. over in Jersey City in St. John's.
Mm-hmm.
And McCoy Tyler would come through there, and we were listening to Freddie Hubbard, Miles Davis, John Coltrane,
mm-hmm.
Ron Carter, you know, at mm-hmm. 14 years old.
That's crazy.
You know. And then it was the Motown thing. We became the Soultown band,
mm-hmm.
and we were with the Soultown Review.
So you did all the songs of Motown.
Yeah, because mm-hmm. the Soultown Review was mm-hmm. trying to be like Motown.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, of course, we had to learn all them songs. Mm-hmm. You know, oh, man, here we go. 10 groups, 20 groups, dealing with the attitude. Yeah, I want the song to play this way. I want to play that way. You know? But that was cool.
That was a great school.
That was building our chops, though.
Right.
Yeah, definitely.
Right. Uh-huh. Well, yeah, and we'll talk about it more in depth a little bit later, but I know that a lot of your songs were recorded in one take, which just blows my mind. I'm super incredible. But I think at that time things were different. And y'all put out a couple of, like, you first put out your Kool and the Gang record. How did that happen? Like, how did you get signed? Like, what was the process of that?
Well, Gene Red had a pending deal with Delight Records.
Mm-hmm.
And his company was called Red Coach Production.
Okay. So wasn't he manager of, like, Parliaments and stuff like that?
No, they all knew him, yeah. Uh-huh. George Clinton, all those mm-hmm. guys. And his father worked with James Brown.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so mm-hmm. that was the very first album we did, mm-hmm. was with Gene. And mm-hmm. it was pretty much an instrumental album.
Right.
You know, Kool and the Gang, Breeze and Soul.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Sea of Tranquility was another song
mm-hmm.
that... trying to think of the artist's name, and he recorded
D'Angelo. Talk about D'Angelo?
D'Angelo, yes.
D'Angelo, did you like that version? Because I love that
version. Yeah,
D'Angelo is a wonderful artist. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, it was interesting how he heard that, because mm-hmm. that was like a... It's like a little different for him to lock in, but he locked right in there, and uh-huh. You know, he did a great job.
Yeah. Hey, D'Angelo, if you're listening, we love you. Yes, fantastic. So you did a couple of live records after that. Mm-hmm. You did Live at the Sex Machine.
Right.
And then at PJ's. Chocolate Buttermilk is one of my favorite jams.
Oh, yeah.
And it's and I know that you appeared on Soul, the show Soul, which we have Melissa Hayeslip, who's Ellis's niece, who just did a movie. Did you know that about that movie that they did? It's called Mr. Soul. It's a documentary of Soul, the show. It's incredible. It's a wonderful, wonderful, just like a homage to the Soul show. So she brought up Chocolate Buttermilk, and I hadn't heard that song in years. I was like, oh my God, it's a bad song. Wonderful. And so all that live music, but also at Live at the Sex Machine, I love the first track because of the positivity. What would the world be like without music? Let the music take your mind. That's a beautiful thing. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask you, how does spirituality play a role in your music? Like, do you see music as prayer?
Yes, we do.
Mm-hmm.
Again, as we stretched out, we used to call ourselves the scientists of sound, because we take the music and build. You take a song like Higher Planes.
Mm-hmm.
You said that we have been down too long, getting down too strong. We got to lift ourselves up to higher planes of understanding.
Yes.
Higher planes of education.
Yes.
You know, love and understanding.
Yes.
Which Kid Rock, I didn't know, he sampled a piece of that record, Love and Understanding.
Uh-huh.
You know, the world needs love and understanding.
That's right.
Who's going to take the weight? That's what's going on today.
That is really what's going on today, and people need this more than ever right now. Speaking of who's going to take the weight, we're gonna listen to that. Can you tell us a little bit about that song? Because I know there's a story behind that.
You want to know that story?
Yeah.
Okay, who's going to take the weight? We're rehearsing in the basement, and we're trying to get our choreography together.
Uh-huh.
A friend of ours we knew was showing us the steps and everything. And then all of a sudden, in the basement, here comes, you know, like Starchy and Hutch, Clemens and this other guy. He comes down in the basement, and they said,
"Police!
Oh, what's this? Uh-huh. Oh, what's that?" And it was drugs. But I think they placed it, or they just set him up. And we said, "Well, I don't know, boy. What do you mean, what's this, what's that?"
Y'all were just trying to get your dance steps.
Yeah, yeah.
And wow. It was that must have been so scary.
Well, who's going to take the weight for this?
Yeah.
Not me.
Yo. <You know? laughs> So what happened? Did y'all go to jail?
Yeah, we went to jail that night.
Whoa. How long? Like what?
24 hours. We got in the paddy wagon, man. I couldn't believe it.
Man.
But we had some heavy people behind us. We got out the next day.
Were there any surprises? I mean, you've had 50 years. Were you ever?
Yeah, well, celebration.
Uh-huh.
After ladies' night. We started with ladies' night.
Right.
We felt good about Celebration, but we didn't know that Celebration was going to become the song that's become.
Iconic. My God.
We were celebrating the fact that we have won 2 American Music Awards for Ladies' Night.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And my brother came up with this idea. You know, he said, you know, at the end of Ladies' Night, this is, let's all celebrate. Okay, this is your night. He said, that's another song.
Yeah.
So he went into the studio. He came back and He played the track first, and it had that sort of, remind me of being back in Ohio, you know, with my grandmother sitting in a rocking chair. Down, 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 down. You know what I mean? It had that country thing happening, you know, and we didn't know that. Man,
that record
still today was.
I guess it was something everybody could identify with, you know?
Yeah, you're right, because they're playing it all over the world. It's just one of those records.
With a Sweet Spot, Thursdays, 10 p.m. only on WBAI 99.5 FM, streaming online at WBAI.org.
Listener-sponsored community radio.